evening and welcome to the Big Replay. Well, once again this season, you can throw the form guide out of the window if you're looking forward to maybe predicting the grand final winners of season 1984. Three games played in Adelaide this afternoon to complete round 19. And on the Big Replay tonight, we're going to look at two of those games. Of course, the big clash at Football Park between Glenelg and, of course, they took on Centrals out there. And down at Unley Oval, we saw Sturt against Nord. Total crowd in Adelaide today of 17,773. And really, when you consider the rain we had in Adelaide last night, almost very good conditions, well, weather-wise for football anyway. At the Unley Oval today, of course, Sturt against Nord. And Ian, the upset of the day.
Sure was, Rick, and really Sturt had nothing going for them at all before today's game. They'd lost 11 of their last 12 games. There were rumblings about coaching changes. They'd been labelled a team of receivers. Rick Davies was out injured before the game started. John Painter pulled out. In the first quarter, they lost Tim Paik and Craig Barbary. Barbary taking the place of John Painter, who pulled out before the game started. And they were off the ground in the first quarter. Eddie Fry grabbed at a hamstring during that first quarter and was obviously inconvenienced for the rest of the game. Darryl Smith in the third quarter went down, which appeared to be a bad knee injury. He played on under a lot of pressure and problems with that knee. And to top it all off, they were 7 points down at three-quarter time and kicked into a four-goal breeze in the last quarter. As I said, they had nothing going for them at all, and yet the real Sturt, the proud Sturt, stood up this afternoon to be counted. Nord, on the other hand, did everything right. They appeared to be going for an easy win, 7 points up at three-quarter time, kicking with that four-goal breeze, but when the chips were down, they didn't produce a thing. Hardly the attitude of a side that intended to go top.
At the Woodville Oval today, in the Battle of the Wooden Spoon, just checking the scores there, West Torrens, 13 goals, 24, 102 points, defeating Woodville, 11 goals, 10, 76, and Jeff Saru was reported in the last quarter of that game for West Torrens. Our first replay tonight comes from Football Park. Of course, the big clash between Glenelg and Central Districts. And at stake was a spot on the top of the premiership table. If Centrals were to win, they go immediately at the top. And of course, Glenelg had to win with a good percentage win to go on top above Port Adelaide. The conditions, well, despite all the overnight rain, the ground at Football Park, once again, in magnificent condition. There was a strong breeze blowing from the south, and Peter Carey won the toss and elected to kick with it. We'll pick up the action at the start of the first quarter.
Opening siren here at Football Park, an important game for both sides. A spot on the top of the premiership table up for grabs. Carey won the toss, Glenelg kicking with the breeze to the north at Football Park. Chance for Talbot, up towards half forward. Stephen Kernahan started at centre half forward. Peter Bubner, the mark in defence for the Bulldogs.
Bubner clears to the outer side, chipping in, almost taken by Simons. And now at the back, a chance for Gibbs to turn around.
Campbell
it is. He turns on, look for McGuinness, couldn't find him. Platten waiting for the grab. Ooh, ducked the head, Nolan, and it's holding the ball. Good tackle.
So McDermott for the Bays, opportunity to put them into attack again. Up towards centre half forward. Fly up, Stephen Kernahan in the middle of the pack. And he started at centre half forward, and Stephen Copping will probably be at full forward.
Yeah, I think it might be Ross Gibbs actually that's standing right in the square, Rick, at this moment. Copping started in the left-hand pocket. Gibbs with his hands on his hips in the goal square. He held back then. It was interesting to watch Bubner just get knocked out quietly by Kernahan. He's got that little knack of just displacing the player. Whether he interferes is debatable.
Kernahan's kick is not good. He's offline. So a minor score to the Bays to open the scoring here at Football Park. They're 1 point. Central's yet to score.
Yes, a lot of people would suggest that Stephen Kernahan gives a little nudge in the back when he gets rid of players. He certainly got rid of Bubner then.
Mark Pryor, the kickoff, goes straight down the ground towards centre half. Back for them, but Peter Carey comes in, reads it perfectly, and he lines up this time with the wind behind him. Directly behind him, there's quite a strong breeze at Football Park, coming pretty well from the south. And so as Glenelg head for the lake end, Peter Carey could get onto this and see it through. Here's the screw, and it is. Glenelg quickly into it, with one goal, one on the board. Central yet to score.
Well, Peter Carey's a big man. He kicked that like as though he was kicking a bag of spuds. Dropped onto his foot very heavily. He didn't time the screw punt away at all well, but his body was lined perfectly and the kick going straight through the centre. And the big fellow showing an amazing burst of pace there to take that mark.
Tigers with the breeze, 7 points after 2 minutes of play. Carey in ruck. He was going to go up against Bythene. The bounce favoured Carey. Went to the big smash. Kernahan looking for support. He's got McGuinness. That left foot kick by McGuinness up towards full forward. Gibbs and Copping lacking a bit of height there. Chance now for Schwert. He was nicely tackled by Copping. Back up coming, Stringer. It's grabbed by McGrath. Another opportunity for Schwert. Stolen by Campbell. Kick across the ground and he's picked out. Who is that he's picked out?
It's like McDermott from here.
McDermott, it is.
He's grown a lot bigger, hasn't he, since he first started playing league football. He's a very fine, strapping fellow. Now, he's got some muscles, and he's had, of course, a lot of this season with injury.
To Chris McDermott, from 30 metres out, the wind behind him is popping through for Glenelg second. 2-1, Central's yet to score.
It's the second time that Chris McDermott has kicked the ball very well indeed from that same position. Showing a little bit of brains and allowing for the wind.
Pryor, good kick out, wide to the outer flank. Carey almost the take. It's Bubner trying to keep it in front of him. He does so, recovers, pops one up high. All sorts of bother by Thien. Now McGrath too. So the Glenelg pressure on. They're playing a hard game, not letting Centrals get any run on at all at this stage. So Carey will contest.
Carey slipped at the wrong time, allows McGuinness to break away onto his natural left boot, booms it up towards the full forward, covers a good 60 metres with that breeze. Kernahan couldn't take it, Gibbs from the back, snaps away. Is this one home? Umpire says yes, so Ross Gibbs gets his first and Glenelg an important one there. 3-3, Centrals no score.
And Glenelg are doing what they've done all season. They've changed that forward line around, they've got players up there and they play them in positions which vary from week to week. Stephen Kernahan this afternoon playing at centre-half forward with Ross Gibbs at full forward. He's got a little bit of mobility in that full forward area. He's a very fine mark, Gibbs. And given an opportunity, one out, I'm sure he'll take a couple.
So the bounce with Glenelg now 21 points up. Going again. Stolen though. Central District trying to force it forward the hard way. Vivian still couldn't get it though. Now Carey in the middle with it. Doubles back, playing on the rover. Out wide. Third grab, McGuinness gets a chance to go forward on the left boot, over half forward. Gibbs in the fly from the back, couldn't handle it, and it will run out of bounds here, despite the efforts of Kidney, the 17-year-old rover for Glenelg.
And Tony McGuinness would have been 2 miles in with the runner bearing down on him, just sort of one of those critical moment jobs.
The throw in, handball comes out to Alan Stringer. A floating kick with a breeze. Didn't give Simons a lot of opportunity, but he read the bounce beautifully. Makes a bit of room. Hooks it back around his body, but that's going close to out of bounds in the fall. In fact, about 5 yards over the line. So a penalty free kick to be taken by McGrath for Centrals.
That's 3 times that Glenelg have kicked out of bounds on the full in this quarter. We've only been going some 14 and a half minutes.
9-0, if you like to look at it that way. And Central's barely needing to get into attack as we get into the second half of this first quarter at Footy Park.
McGrath kicked that one out of bounds on the full. So another error, this time by the defence. Simon's kick, looking for Kernahan. Bubner got the spall away. Nice little give by Copping to Gibbs. Gibbs, have a look at this, to Alan Stringer. And Alan Stringer runs into the open goal. And Glenelg get another. They're 4-3. They're 27 points. Central's 0.
Well, Glenelg taking advantage of the fact that McGrath's made his second error in rebound. The second time of the quarter, he's kicked the ball out of bounds on the full. He came back across the face of the goal, and a very good take by Gibbs, and he's got the ball out with a long handball to Alan Stringer. Didn't find the body, but fortunately Stringer got the ball to bounce for him. He controlled it, and the kick.
So plenty of pressure on Central Districts to get into this game now. Bythien goes for the tap and gets it this time. Doesn't go very far though, because Stringer picks it up for the Bays, puts it back into attack. His kick was ill-directed. Gee, Rowe's got unlucky not to be paid the mark.
Good play by McDermott, though. He knocked it out of his hand when he fumbled.
It's a superb pass on to Simons, too. Now Simons centres it. Not quite the take by Marshall. Plenty of pressure. He's got the ball now. Has to get it out the back. Centrals knock each other over. Krieg. Down in the middle there. Talbot's the one with the ball. At least he did have it. But another vigorous tackle by Platten. Not only a good ball player, but he certainly tackles it.
The bounce in the centre square. The tap away towards Campbell. He couldn't come out with it. Chance now for McGuinness. Gets his handball to Marshall. And Marshall's trying to get away from Platten. Surely legged. He is. Gets the free kick. We've got to have a bit of pace to run away from John Platten. Marshall's kick up towards half forward. Gibbs a big fly. Couldn't pull it down.
Tap out the back, goes towards Butner. Bay for the free and didn't win it.
Yes, he tried to break the tackle then, and when the ball was knocked out of his hands, he's very lucky not to be penalised for holding the ball because he had the opportunity to get rid of it, and he tried to break.
Bounced pretty well at centre-half forward for Glenelg. Platten took it. Straight up in the air goes the kick, though. Dermot almost the grab, and now Central District's out of trouble. Rowe uses the run. Clears it out to the outer side. Wright couldn't take it. Seabone, plenty of choices. Decides to kick, but misplaced. So here comes Bubner into the centre. Finds Walsworthy. He plays it on. Now Central's for the first time get it over their half forward line. It's forced on. Couldn't see who the player over the ball was.
Fraser.
And now Nolan has come right up from defence, has a shot. Right into the square. Wilfer Wilson lets it go and it bounces the wrong way. 1 point to Central's, their first score, 17 minutes into the quarter. Glenelg 4-3.
I think Nolan's playing on the half-forward flank, in fact, Keith. He's resting up there. I noticed him there earlier. He's on John McFarlane.
Bays go down the middle of the ground. That kick reaching the centre square. Kerry couldn't take the mark. Finally to Bythene. He's going to go short. The lead of Fraser. Sport away from behind. Salisbury. Just took his eyes off it for a moment. Tap away by McFarlane. Seabone made hard work of that. And the ball will be bounced at centre-half forward position for Centrals.
Yes, Trevor Rowe's resting at half-back and he's changing with Chris McDermott today. That means that Nolan has gone to play up on that half-forward flank where Rowe was named as a change player with Peter Creek.
Carey, knees over the ball. Van Dommel, the smaller player, builds the pack up. And Coach Kevin Neal sitting in the grandstand, probably wondering how Centrals are going to hold Glenelg with this breeze. Already they've got 4-3 after only 19 minutes of play. Chance now with Kidney. He hooks it around towards McDermott. Trevor Rowe made front spot that time. It was spoiled away and we'll see a throw in out of side centre wing. The Centrals unable to make use of that attack.
So Nolan, I should say Carey, runs in for the Bays. Van Dommel leapt up, got a big thump away, only to see it go out of bounds. Just 10 or 15 metres closer to the Central's goal. It's on the outer side. And Glenelg using the breeze well in the first quarter. Bythene against Carey. They fall over. And in fact, it's played against Carey.
Yes, he's hanging on to Bythene's arm.
Platten plays it on. Goes for goal. Into the square. Fraser, almost a take. It's right. It was the try for the take. And it's cleared away by Salisbury. He got bundled out of it after the kick had gone. Just over the line. It bounced just inside before it went over the line, and so the throw in is in the half forward line for Central District.
Yes, Wilbur Wilson blocked quite nicely in that goal square then to give an opportunity for Michael Wright, but his grip on the ball just a little loose.
Carey and Bythene got his hands to it, to Platten, a short one around the corner, looking for Fraser. He's got that one. That front spot on Duthie.
It's a tough kick too here, Rick. Wind coming from the southwest, it's straight into his face. How will he kick the ball? We'll wait and see.
He's going to have a go. Left foot drop, the umpire having a look. It looks very good. Confident start by Fraser. It will help a 4-3. Centrals have got their first one on the board there, 1-1.
The Central Districts are now only 3 goals behind after a very good kick by Robert Fraser. The mark he took was equally as good. And he kicked that ball very strongly, and he just came in with his leg from just slightly from the left post to the right, straight into the breeze. Very, very powerful kick.
And now it's Bubner who will fly for Central District. He puts it forward to Nolan, who's pressured by McFarlane from the back, picks up the free kick. The Central's into attack again, all played into the man. Wright trying for it. Chance for Vivian, gets hold of it, turns it round, still onto it, on to Bubner. Bubner, hand pass on quickly, well avoided there by Norsworthy. Norsworthy lines up and punches it to the goal. That's the way to get the goals against the breeze. And a real save of the Centrals. You've got a 2-1 now behind Glenelg's 4-3.
What
quite a sensation to start the third quarter here at Football Park. Tony McGuinness went onto the ground and unfortunately has come off, and David Holst has taken his place.
He's vomiting very heavily, in fact.
Peter Bubner with the ball. The Bays lead by 27 points. They're with the breeze. Peter Carey up towards half forward, looking for Stephen Kernahan. Peter Bubner got the spoil away. Now Hearn, monstrous long hand ball into the breeze to David Bubner. Makes space. Chips one away, but the kick was a shocker to the arms of Salisbury. Salisbury to McFarlane. 33, still playing league football.
Ed well.
He's found Tony Simons. Van Gommel's going to make sure he doesn't take off. Tony Simons with the left boot towards half forward. Up goes Kernahan. Again, Peter Bubner spoiling away. Trevor Rowe is in there battling. A wild handball out. Went to the arms of Marshall. Marshall snapped one across his body up towards full forward. Pryor and Gibbs there. Gibbs has got it now. Couldn't do much with it. Pat Swirt. The umpire's whistle's gone, in fact.
The free kick was paid against Gibbs, who manhandled Pryor. Had him round the neck after the ball had gone. And so Pryor from the pocket to the outer side. Bubner at the back couldn't take it. Bythene. He clears it with a hurried left footer, but McFarlane will take it again. He's had a great game playing on the half back line. He gets it in towards Seabohm. Seabohm to centre half forward. She's getting under it. Good mark, Talbot. That may be a concussion that we saw McGuinness go off with, because there's nothing wrong with him, certainly in arm and limb. Ran out onto the ground, but suddenly was sick before the start of the game and had to run off, and then went down to the change rooms. As the ball goes right into the full forward position, Kernahan couldn't take it. Copping read it off the pack, and he's being grabbed, and it has to be holding it to him by Van Dommel. So the bounce within metres of the Glenelg goal as they go into attack with the wind in the third quarter.
Central District a bit more disciplined this quarter too. I noticed Peter Bythene staying back at half forward with big Peter Carey as the ball hits the post.
Stephen Kernahan with that kick. The bounce, I think he grabbed it out of the air and just threw it onto the boot and smack into the timber work. Mark Pryor towards the outer side of Football Park. Off hands, Tony Simons at the back. He was forced to get rid of it. Chance now for Holst, who's come on to replace McGuinness. He's appealing for the free kick. Carey, nicely tackled, play on again. Now Bythene. Gets around Kidney, long hand ball to Krieg. Krieg with the left boot, looking for Mark Norsworthy. Salisbury in front. Balls away nicely. Read that well.
Salisbury is in charge of everything that comes in that area. He's got, he thinks that area, that defence is all his, and every ball that comes there is his, and he's just treating it just that way.
Glenelg by 28 points as Wright goes up against Carey. Platten keeps it in front of him. Tries to come out of the pack. Was held as he did so. Bayons is the umpire. Holst turns it in towards the centre. Vivian in front. Marshall spoils. Vivian recovered well. Time he comes out grandstand side. Wilson, oh, that's a good mark under pressure. Has to be 15 metres. Suppose Russell was intent on playing on, grabbing the ball away from Wilson. May have thought it was neutralised.
I would hope that he wouldn't have kicked a kick like that to his teammates, though.
No, it was not a great kick if you're going to have one. Wilson spears one low, looking for Fraser. Graham with it. He has to run right round wide. Gets one onto the left boot, right into the square. Michael Wright from the back. Ooh, good take, though, in front of him. Seba.
He's been a great player for the league this season. He's at full back at the moment.
John Seaboom, short to David Holst, who's got a panic. He's going to boom it across the centre square. Kernahan and Bubner again. Neither player able to take the mark. Van Dommel to Krieg. Krieg to Rowe. He's put him under pressure. Carey, nice handball on. Oh, McDermott got one in the back after he got rid of it. Marshall booms one into the goal square. This could be a good kick. It is. So Glenelg with the breeze and now 7-8. Central's 2-4.
There's a bit of a shamozzle at the centre half forward area, but it was David Marshall, in fact, who got clear. Then he just liked to run into that half forward area. He's been shifted to the centre wing on Peter Vivian. And Vivian then caught in the in-between play where he had to go and do a bit of chasing. Marshall just dropped away from the play, read the ball coming forward, and then kicked one of those delightful drop punts that he's renowned for. And so in his 150th game, he's finally got a nice easy kick and kicked a goal that's put Glenelg a long way in front.
34 points, in fact, and It's a long ways. They've got the breeze all this quarter. McDermott picks up the free that all the Glenelg supporters thought he should have got 5 minutes ago. Punches it to the half forward line. Stephen Kernahan plays on quickly. Campbell, and it looks good. See, it's gone in deep. Spoiled on the line. Talbot tries to get through. Trapped. So Central District breathe again. As Pryor tries to get it out, but underneath that, you can see who the Bay Stephen player is Copping. On the bottom. It's a Stephen Copping. He's gone a long way out from the full forward position. And so the bounce now, about 30 metres out from the Glenelg goal. Kernahan, gee, picks one off and has another go. Gee, he's offline today. He's had one, two, three, four, five shots for, so far, 2 points.
4 points and one out of bounds on the full. I've got him.
That's what you
got. I reckon he's having a really bad day. You're quite right, Keith. Things are not going well.
Ball with David Bubner towards centre wing. Spalled away from Nolan. Chance for Platten to pick up. It's a grubby old kick as well. Has three or four bounces. Now picked up by Holst, a solid player. Gets his kick away. Found Carey. Lucky, but Carey was in the vacant position. Comes across the ground. Not a good kick either. Peter Krieg. Acting captain of Centrals, of course, with Stephen Trigg out for what could be the remainder of the season. Peter Bubner plays it on quickly to Platten. Platten's off to Phil Graham. I've seen a lot of Phil Graham, but when he's had the opportunities, he's tried to make the most of them. He's won himself the free kick.
See, that free kick's the one that they don't really need to get. A player taking the ball cleanly, and even if he gets tackled around the head, if he can get the ball cleanly, play it onto a teammate, becomes a run-on play. Instead of that, it's a bit stop-startish.
He's looking for Wilson. Wilson got it to Vivian. Vivian's kick to Fraser has just stayed in bounds, so at least Centrals have held it in their forward area, the right forward pocket.
It's where the throw-in takes place with the sun coming out, but it's a very cool day down here for about 8,000 people watching the game between two sides who could go top after today. One of them could go top, I should say. McDermott, good night. 15 metres. So Big Mac goes on towards the half forward line looking for Kernahan, and that's a good mark in front this time by Bubner.
Peter Bubner from the edge of the square. Poor kick. I said earlier the skill level's not that high. Marshall was unable to take it, but he's got himself a free kick
for holding the man. Unbelievable. He went for the ball, took it, and he's got a free kick for holding the bat.
Bit of Vivian the offender. Marshall's kick towards half forward. Copping. Nice little leap. Gave it to Simons. Put Simons under pressure. Simons got it to Holst. Holst tried to strike the tackle. Wild handball away towards Campbell. Copping. And Norsworthy. With Stephen Copping winning the ball.
And Peter Krieg looked careless on the tackle. Copping, as he was weaving, of course, went down low. As he went the turn, and was hit around the head. At the nil, they're 5-4 in front. And this goal, of course, will put them 40 points in front if Stephen Copping can score from 40 metres.
So Stephen Copping comes in, fires it towards the sticks, and the umpire says that's good. For Stephen Copping, that's about 301 goals in his South Australian career and his second in the game today. Glenelg now out, 8 goals, 8. They are 56, Central's 2-4-16. David Holst has ended up with the ball. He's a strong, well-built lad and should have really no trouble with this distance. It's about 60 metres. He can boom it a long way on his day. Puts it up. It's going to go right to the goal line. Plays will fly in the middle. It's Stephen Kernahan. See him do it so often.
Yeah, that's judgment, isn't it? Fantastic.
The umpire bringing Stephen around on, well, about a 50-degree angle. Hasn't got a goal on the board today. We're only just talking a moment ago. His kicking's been offline. Something like 5 or 6 shots for 2 points and 3 out of bounds on the full. But that one's true and accurate. Glenelg, 9 goals, 9 now. Central's a lot to do. They're on 2 goals, 4.
When Stephen Kernahan gets into that full forward area, and he started there today. Well, sorry, last week, but today he's been shifted to centre-half forward, but he dropped back into there. when he can put his hands up and with a player that ability to mark the ball, he can only has to take to a match. And another player could spend all day working hard. He gets the ball so close to the goals because of his great skill at marking. And in the middle of that pack, he had players all around him. His judgment was absolutely superb.
So Ian de Rouge in the middle for Central Districts now, and Cloessi has gone into the centre patch as well for the Bulldogs. De Rouge wins the tap. Out wide, though, to Simons. Van Dommel, gee, used it well. McFarlane, he's playing well too. Stayed in front of him. The ball forced right out wide and out of bounds.
Darren Cloessi's come on and he's fired up. He's got to get his team lifted if they're to get out of trouble here. He's a player that can do it on his day. Norsworthy. Ball tackled by McDermott. He comes out with the ball, dummies around De Rouge. Gets it up towards the pocket area.
Kernahan again. Second grab in as many minutes.
Bubba did everything right then. Front spot. The ball just drifted in a little bit with the breeze. But Kernahan read it superbly from the back.
It's his eighth mark now, Keith. So even though he and Peter Bubner have had a great clash, Kernahan in the last few minutes is just getting on top.
So he's going to get more opportunities too. I think Glenelg are looking a little bit more smooth than they did earlier.
Stephen Kernahan's kick. Umpire having a very close look at this one, but he's just the wrong side of the post. Another minor score. Glenelg 9-10, Central's 2-4.
And sadly, it's looking a bit like a cakewalk at this stage. 19 shots to 6. You wouldn't believe that it was the third side that was beating the second side by such a margin.
Is it seems that the fact that Glenelg have changed their forward line around a bit with Patrick Squirt playing on that half-back flank, etc., that may have thrown Central's out of gear a little bit, particularly in their attacking department from the defensive action.
Butler tried to take the ball off the kick-out, couldn't handle it, so out of bounds again. And a chance for Central's to clear. Bubner will fly against Kernahan. Neither of them can get it. Campbell read it at the back. On the bottom of the pack, Glenelg still Talbot forward, tried to find McDermott. Now Simons, Vivian's in front of him. And it's pretty messy football. Oh, and a bit of interest develops as two players go down at the bottom. McDermott is one and Norsworthy is the other. McDermott on the bottom for the Bays, just getting up now. Still a bit interested. Norsworthy being led away by one of his own players and takes the free kick.
So with that, the umpire said, I'll save me bouncing. I'll give it a free.
Good free kick.
So Mark Norsworthy towards centre wing. Peter Carey, tremendous player for Glenelg. Uses his weight well again there. He's played something of over 300 club games for Glenelg. Of course, he holds the record at the moment.
That Peter time Bubner. It was Bubner. Who read the ball better. And maybe it is a bit difficult to read, and when the ball comes in long with the breeze, Peter Bubner goes short to Platten. Gee, that only just came off. There's plenty of pressure from Kidney. Oh, thank you very much. I don't think you might have seen that. David Holt just lined up as if he was going to for the gold medal at Los Angeles. In the boxing, that is. Now, Vivian forward to Fraser, but right in front of him, Doothy played it well.
See, Vivian didn't attack that goal. Run down the ground, bounced at one stand and run right to the goal line, but he went for a short pass and Doothy read it magnificently.
And he's got himself another 15 metre.
A lot of frustration with Central Districts at the moment. Fraser gave away one, which he shouldn't have. Wilson's run over the mark, and Chris Doothy's advanced about 50 metres altogether.
Doothy's kick covers the centre square. Peter Buckner playing well on that half-back line. Set to beat Kernahan, his 7th. In fact, his 12th kick coming up, and his 7th mark. Up they go, tapped on, Platten towards Krieg. Krieg goes short, he's going to come out wide looking for Norsworthy.
Salisbury recovers it well to Marshall, back to Salisbury. He's met as he kicks the ball away down to Stringer. Stringer was held and will pick up the free kick. I don't know what happened to the Central's player then. He went down like a light.
Yeah, that was Stringer just back spoke to him and went past. He only didn't speak to him with his mouth.
No. So the ball now in towards centre half forward for Glenelg. leading Rowe for Central District. McDermott right behind him, upsets him. McDermott recovers well, lines up, has a shot. Goes right into the square, Kernahan from the back. There it is again. What a tremendous player. He's standing, a very good player in Peter Bubner, a great defender. Kernahan wins out again.
Very bad. Looks like he breathed on him fairly severely then, Alan Stringer. He's hit him right in the nose. Or thereabouts.
And he'll be coming off. Kernahan goes for his second goal. And Glenelg clear out. 10 goals, 10. Thrashing Central Districts 2-4.
Yes, with that kick coming in and Stephen Kernahan drifting down. Peter Bubner on the two previous occasions out in the field play, played behind Stephen Kernahan, came up and took the mark. And then on that occasion, he got in front. And when you play in front of Kernahan, it seems he's got that great talent to be able to ease you just underneath the ball by a fraction. And his judgment is so superb that he just seems to be able to pluck it from the top of your fingertips. It's a great ability to have because he never pushes players in the back severely where he looks as though he's interfering. He just quietly holds his ground, eases the player under the ball, and then takes it right off the top.
Stephen Nolan's come on to replace McGrath, who's gone down to the rooms, and I'd say maybe requiring some stitches. Whistle's gone again. Holster's given away the free kick to Peter Bytheen. So Bytheen, with the sun shining, goes short to Peter Bubner. Gets around McFarlane, takes off, uses the pace, gets caught, gets it to Graham. Graham's kick, well, there are the errors again, off the side of the boot. Gee, surely that was out of bounds.
No, it wasn't.
Here, Graham's kept it, given it to Platten.
The umpire on Bolnup's down. Look, the umpire was not unsighted. He'd certainly fallen over, but he managed to watch the ball over his head. Platten, goal.
So Central's at 3-4 now. Glenelg 10-10, in the greatest comedy you'd ever wish to see in your life. The goal umpire, I think he really knew that the ball was out of bounds, and he'd run across in an effort to tell the boundary umpire, but the boundary umpire was a long way behind the game. Wilbur Wilson pinched the ball, snooked back inside the plane. The goal umpire then backpedaled very quickly, and he just must have tripped on himself as he was coming back, and he went flat in the middle of his back in the goal square. Then the ball was kicked, and there he was, looking up like the Sergeant Major, and he was looking up into the sky to see the aeroplane flying over the top.
Meanwhile, back in the centre, Bubner got that one. Platten couldn't get his kick very far. Phil Graham trying to barge his way through. And big Campbell surely got that one too high from Peter Bubner and wins the free kick. And the little push as he tries to get back to his mark. So, Rodney Campbell, son of the coach, puts the bays towards the half forward line. In the middle, well, there he is again. He's come alight all of a sudden, Stephen Kernahan.
What a quarter he's had.
Yes, Bubner was up in the centre then, as you can see, and Kernahan dropped back, and all credit to Campbell. He kicked that ball straight to Kernahan because he knew that Bubner wasn't there.
Kernahan, 20 kicks, 10 of them coming from marks. He lines up to have a shot at his third goal. Long way out, the wind's right behind him though, and he's come just, he's not done it again, he's shaved the post again. You see the post wobbling, there's no doubt he hit it. So Glenelg are now 10-11, and Central's a 3-4.
It was Clohessy that brought the ball back into play, De Rouge was interfered with.
That's Carey again, he's a great lover of grabbing arms, the old Pete. But of course, due credit to, he was trying to stop the player playing on.
There's a 35-metre penalty from the umpire. Bytheen with the ball to Vivian. One bounce. Oh, didn't control it. Holst went through without it. Campbell back to Wayne Stringer. Stringer's kick up towards half forward. De Rouge in front. Couldn't bring down the mark. Tapped out the back. Chance now for Alan Stringer. Gets his handball across to Marshall. And Marshall should walk into the goal and pop it through. Marshall's second goal, and Glenelg are now 11 goals, 11. They're 77 points, Central's 3-4, 22.
The final scoreline at Football Park this afternoon, Glenelg 15 goals, 14, 104 points, defeating Central Districts on 9 goals, 9, 63. And with that win, Glenelg now go to the top of the table by 0.05% over the Magpies. The goal kickers for Glenelg, Kernahan got 3, Copping, Marshall and Campbell 2, while for Central Districts, Platten got 3, Fraser and Wilson 2. And the stats from the game, in the kick department, Glenelg 216 to Central's 181, the marks 69 to 53, handballs 100 to 71, the frees Well, Glenelg had 23 to Central's 39, the Rucks out of centre 7-8, and the scoring shots probably tells the story, 29 to Glenelg and 18 to Central Districts. Well, after the game, we chose Robert Oatey to wander down to the rooms to talk to Graham Campbell, and Graham took the opportunity to offer some advice to the media.
Graham, were you particularly happy with today's game?
I'm delighted.
Why should I be upset? We won the game by 7 goals or something.
I didn't say you should be upset. No. I mean, were you happy with the way the lads attacked them?
Well, I'm rapt because a lot of critics, I don't know if you're one of them, have said this is the time of the year we go to water.
I haven't said that.
Well, I don't know, but some of your compatriots probably have. I know David Hook said it this morning on 5DN, and I know that, who was it? Oh, Peter Mead on the Channel 9 show. Sorry, it's not your station. He said last week the obvious side to miss out in the double chance is Glenelg. Now, I hope we've shut a few people up, that's all. It was a pressure game. If it wasn't, I don't know what is. It was the top spot, and we won it by 7 goals. So I would say we've answered some people around town that claim that we don't handle the pressure too well. Would you?
I thought you played very well. Stephen Coffin.
Would you say we've answered that innuendo that we don't handle the pressure very well?
Was it
a pressure game?
Yeah, it was a good game for
no,
you.
No, but it was a pressure game. It was a tough spot, Bob.
Yeah.
I mean, it's got to be pressure. I mean, pre-match I'm talking about. That's when you quiver and shake and worry about a game, pre-match. And that's when you're supposed to lose it or win it. I thought we showed an amazing calm approach to the match. We won it quarter by quarter, and they kicked 4 goals to the breeze the last quarter, but hell, they had to do something. They kicked 3 for the entire first 3 quarters. So I'm well pleased with our defensive action. We played with 2 players very much under a cloud. Tony McGuinness had been bilious and was diarrheic prior to the game. We decided to play him. Stephen Copping played on 1 groin again. But then, nevertheless, we took the punt. They played and, they were under some sort of restriction throughout the whole day. So we in effect ran around with 16 people we knew could really compete hard and push hard all day. So that again makes it a more than, admirable performance from a few of the blokes that were out there. Very pleased.
Have you done anything special in the last fortnight in sort of preparation for finals coming up? In training, I mean?
Well, we didn't do anything last weekend. I thought we needed a letdown. Bob, we've been up for a long time. When you work it out, the season's 19 weeks old now. So we've been playing for 18 weeks plus 4 Escort Cup games. That's 22 straight Saturdays we've been playing. So I thought I needed a letdown. So if that was, I had a sort of a reverse build-up. We had a complete letdown, did nothing at the weekend. We trained pretty hard Tuesday night. We had our usual running over Sturt College on Wednesday, and we had our usual 3/4 of an hour workout Thursday night in preparation for this game. So we did do something a little different in as much as we didn't play last Saturday. And I think we needed to have that rest, quite frankly. We had Stephen Kernahan under a big cloud after the North Adelaide game. That's what annoys me. We beat North by 3 points, and people were saying, oh, yes, it was just the performance, and they fell over the line. Other sides haven't got within 12 goals of North over the last 4 weeks. If Port Adelaide and South Adelaide are the top sides, they lost by 90 points and 76 points respectively. We beat them, yet people were poo-pooing the performance. I don't get how people think football is won on the day. We beat them. And from a lot of people's summing up these days, North have got some sort of a side, and they probably have. But they didn't beat us. Yet our performance is put down as, they only beat North by 3 points. And that rankles your little bog.
Yes,
but then again, it keeps us, I suppose, on the ball, as the saying goes. But I do hope some of those critics have crawled back into their corner, at least for a week, and they might give us some little bit of credit next Saturday when they talk about what Glenelg might or might not do in a game of football.
Talking about calmness, I've been a critic of anything of Scott Salisbury, but today he was absolutely magnificent. His calmness, he's certainly become a calm player, particularly his attack on the ball, superb.
And he was playing on the best rover in the competition, let's be honest about it. I have great admiration for John Platten. I think he's a marvellous player. And I said to Scotty, you've got to beat the boy today. And Platten's put over Scotty a couple of times. I'll be honest about that too. He's a live wire, and he's it's no disgrace for Platten to get a few kicks on there. John Platten, that is. I hate calling people by their last name. But I do think that Scotty did the job today as well as he did it against Mark Naley 10 weeks ago at Adelaide Oval. He had the pressure on him that day too. Remember saying to him, Scotty, you're playing on Mark Naley today. He said, he won't beat me. And I love the way he built himself up for the big-time opponent. And that'll be on again next Saturday, of course.
Yeah, sure will. What about Stephen Copping's training, Graham?
Does it worry you a bit? It does worry me enormously, Bob. Yes. He can't train. And at halftime, I asked him, should he come off? Because the man couldn't run. And so we had a bit of a third quarter plan to kick the ball to him rather than make him run for it. He got a goal in the third quarter. He got a goal in the second quarter. But he is a continual worry for me. And he may not play next Saturday, quite honestly. You've got to just really be realistic about it and say to yourself, well, what's best for us? It might be best for us to rest Steve and try and get him right for the finals, because we are going to be in the finals. Even our worst attractor would admit that, and hopefully the double chance. And even our worst attractor might say we've got a silly chance of finishing in the top three. Seeing we're on top at the moment.
Right.
I think we're on top. You work that out?
I think you're on top.
Yeah, well, not bad, is it, for a club that struggles a little?
Well, good luck to you, Graham. Thanks very much.
We're trying hard, Bob.
You're doing well, too.
We're trying hard.
Talking about the pressure of trying to win football games, Robert, I reckon you've jumped in a little pressure cooker there after the game.
Yeah, I got in a bit of trouble, didn't I?
Hey, we sent you down to interview him. He was interviewing you.
He's very good, too. And by the way, Graham, I'm all for the coaches. Having been one, I know just what it's like when they're all into you. But Glenelg were terrific, and I know that today he would be well and truly proud of the players, the way they went about the game. It was a game that people ran a lot and tackled a lot. I think there was a bit lacking in some of the disposal skills, the quick reflex to the body and the ability to run away, particularly from central districts. They couldn't get anything going at all this afternoon, and they had a great deal of trouble. But, of course, we had a talk in the interview there about Scott Salisbury. He played a fantastic game. Any ball that went into defence, he seemed to have a right to it and nobody else. And probably that was due in no small part, though, to the fact that Chris Duthie played so well at full-back and John Seabohm at centre-half-back, and they reversed positions occasionally. But he read off hands, and John McFarlane was there to support. They had a very, very good back line, Wayne Stringer as well. So Glenelg had nothing to complain about in defence. Stephen Kernahan relished the opportunities, though, when they came to him, particularly in the third quarter when he played very well, even though I thought Peter Bubner showed what great talent he has with some of his dashes away from centre-half back. Well, what about poor old Centrals? They're in a bit of strife, there's no doubt about that. They can't seem to beat Glenelg at Football Park. They haven't beaten them there since 1974, and they'll certainly be looking forward to beating them in the finals this year. In their last five games, they haven't beaten Port, South or Glenelg, three teams in the finals, so they've certainly got to lift their pecker up somewhat, and I'm sure that'll be a bit of a challenge for them for the finals, Rick.
Certainly will be, Robert. That was all the action today from Football Park. After this short break, we'll go to Unley Oval.